Good morning. My name is Henk. I'm a software developer from the Netherlands, and we are going to unleash some AI into the wild in these 45 minutes. And as the title may suggest, it is about releasing killer robots over in the world. It is not going to be. But they are getting pretty scary right now at the moment, right? So I'm going to talk these 45 minutes on the question how AI can improve the efficiency of medical field workers in remote Uganda. So my name is Henk Boelman, and my official title is I'm a cloud solution architect. So most of the day, I'm trying to shape the cloud, mainly Azure, to the direction of what the client wants to make the software run in it. I have Twitter, GitHub, and everything I tell you today, you can find back on my blog, henkboelman.com. I work at a company called Heroes, and I run two Microsoft user groups, and I'm a Microsoft MVP in the direction of AI. So like I said, I like to make software. I'm doing that now for over 25 years. I started with writing small programs in BASIC, Pascal, moved to PHP, did some Java, and now I'm doing C# development, Azure, and some little bit of Python. And still, I can be very happy, like that guy there, if things actually work. But for me, something changed the last 5 years. For sure, everyone has noticed that the cloud is there, and that we can run everything in the cloud very smoothly. And we don't have to drive to our data centers anymore in the middle of the night if some client application crashes. But also one other thing really changed for me and what me really got excited about the time we're living in now today. And that is that AI is becoming more and more common and more available for developers to use. So if we look at the big companies like Microsoft, like Amazon, like IBM and Google, we see that they are trying to put the AI they trained in the cloud and make it available through APIs. So we can use them as a developers very easily in our applications without the hassle of training them and doing all the data science-y stuff. So besides that, I'm also a volunteer for SUBI Reach Out Foundation. And SUBI Reach Out Foundation is a small NGO in Uganda, in Ghana, and in Burkina Faso. And what we do is we do wound care. So we go to schools in Ugandan villages, and we clean the wounds so they don't get infected and that they can lead to very terrible, terrible things there because they don't have access to medical care. So we reach about 1,000 children every week. And what you see here is the documentation we have for all these patients. So that is quite a big problem if we come back and we want to follow up on some treatments. It's very hard to look in those documentations or on all those books like a year back or 2 years back, and we don't have any insights about the project. So that is why we started developing our platform called TendoCare, TendoCare.ai. And the platform is really a platform that should enable the medical field workers to be a little bit more effective in their field and give us some more insights about what is going on. How many people do we treat? What are the type of wounds we treat? And how can we act on that data? So let me show you a small video on... Can I have some sound? Let me try and fix the sound very quickly. So, little distraction. So let me show you a video about how a day looks like when they're doing wound care in the village. I actually shot this myself when I was there in February doing it and was testing out the app we made.
when we make children, they are now back in school. The impact has been so much.
So that is how it looks in Uganda at the school at the moment. So we go there in the morning with a team of 5 people and we start treating wounds. The children line up. So we need to have an app that was very effective and very fast and should, for all things, make the work for those nurses easier. It has to give us better insights. And for me as a developer, because I do this in my spare time, it had to be a little fun to make also. So with this new AI thing I was talking about, we could really rethink the way we are going to do this app. So we had the mobile first, the content first, anything first. So I thought it was time now to put AI first and ask by everything we do in the user interface, how can AI make this app easier to use? So I was really focusing on the usability of this application. I want to develop it on a Mac. I wanted to run Visual Studio and see if Microsoft was right that I could develop it on a Mac. But as you can see here, I'm now back to my Dell Windows laptop, so you can all think of how that adventure ended. So I used Xamarin. Xamarin is a thing where from Microsoft where you can easily create mobile apps. You can use Xamarin Forms and you can just drag and drop almost your applications, and you can both deploy it and compile it for iOS and for Android. I used Visual Studio App Center for deployment and testing the app. And the really cool thing about Visual Studio App Center is that I could just deploy it only to the devices of my medical field workers, so I didn't have to send it all to the through the app stores. I started with the .NET Core backend, which I never done, but was really cool and really easy. And I used Visual Studio Team Services for Microsoft to deploy it, but now they've renamed it to Azure DevOps. And I used GitHub to put my source code because I wanted to have that separate and I want to open source it eventually if it starts working and becoming bigger, so people can actually help developing this platform more and more. So this is kind of the overview of the infrastructure I used for this app. So we have an app that is connecting to a traffic manager in Azure. The traffic manager finds the nearest region. So we have one in South Africa, almost up and running, and we have one in Western Europe. It connects to the web app, to the API. Behind there is a Cosmos database, that is the Microsoft Document DB, where we store everything in, and that automatically geo-replicates all over the globe. We use Active Directory business to consumer for authentication. We use some cognitive services, some Azure functions, some storage, and application insights to see what is going on in the application. So I want to talk about some of the cognitive services we used in this application. So cognitive services are those machine learning models that are put in the cloud by Microsoft and made available through an API. There are actually around 30 to 40 different offerings at the moment, but you can all put them in 4 different regions, areas. So we have vision to make your application see, speech to make your application listen and talk back, language to understand what is being spoken, and knowledge and search if you think it is a good idea to tap the knowledge of Bing in your web applications. And then there is Cognitive Services Labs, and that is the place where the Microsoft product teams put their new things they're working on for you to try out for free. So you can really see what the new thing is going to be like in around 1 year. Now, the first problem we had with this application was that we had to look up our patients. And traditionally, I would have done that by creating a search box where I would type a name. But if your name is this, like a child comes to you and says, hey, I'm Kiemba Biyundo, then I actually have a hard time to typing that. Let's even say this name. I can't even read it what it says. And they're wearing gloves, which is also not the best if you're using a mobile phone. So that is why we thought, hey, let's try out this face recognition thing in the cloud. So we wanted to be able to take a picture of the child, send it through our API, and get back the corresponding patient file. And that could be done, according to the documentation, by the Face API from Microsoft. So you have an image of a face, of multiple faces, you send it to the API, and you get back like really cool insights about the faces you see on it. Like if someone is smiling, some gender, age, glasses. But also you get back some emotions. You get back like, whoa, that is big. Next. So let's zoom in a little bit about the details we get back from this API. So you see the face, you see the rectangle, so it tells you where the face is in the image. You get all these cool points, like where the eyebrows are, where the nose is, and where the mouth is, so that you can actually make like those cool Snapchat kind of overlays. It tells you like your age, your hair color, tells you if you wear makeup, if you have a mustache or something, tells you the emotions. But it also tells you one other important thing. It tells you something about the quality of your image. So if you start using photos to train your face API, always check first if the picture is good enough to use for face detection. Otherwise, your model or the API will give you also back very weird results. Send crap in, get crap out. So what we did is we take the picture, we send it to the API, and get the patient file back. So we, in that method, we start detecting a face, then we start by identifying the face. If we don't find the face in our system, we register it with the Face API, create a new patient file, and send the patient file back. And if it is recognized, we load it by the person ID we got back from this API, and we return the patient file. So everything we do in one call, because the app is in Uganda, the API is somewhere in Azure. So we wanted to do not like 20 different calls, we wanted to do like one big call to get all the data in. So let me show you on the screen here like a small demo of the app. So you start the app up, you log in with the Active Directory B2C. It is fairly fast, even in Uganda. We log in. It loads my profile as caretaker. Take a picture of yourself or the patient. Yes, click. And then it loads the patient file. You can all see when I start developing this app, I was doing it on my room at home. And then you can start adding cases and cases about wounds I apparently don't have. But face detection on white males around 30 to 40 works perfectly fine. But what we found out in February when we were in Uganda, it works also on children and also with children of a little bit of a skin color. But if you go below the age of 8, it does not really work. It will just give you like back a random person. So we had to think of something else, some like a little bit of extras if it didn't work. So that is why we thought, hey, let's give the patients something which we can later on scan and we can recognize them by. So we give them like a cool keychain, we write something on it, and we can identify them later with that. So, and that is where the Microsoft Custom Vision Service can become handy. The Microsoft Custom Vision Service is a service that enables you to train your own custom vision models by just uploading a few images to a website, hit the train button, and you have your own API up and running. So for this example, we're going to use stickers. So you take like 50 photos of one sticker, you tag it with the correct name, and you upload it to that website. You hit train, you get a model. That is called classification. You can also do object detection. Then you have to upload images and drag like a rectangle around the object you want to detect, and then hit the train button. So still, it is uploading images, tag them, and hit the train button, and you get like this cool vision model to use in your applications. So we have classification. It just tells you, I probably think it is this sticker. Or we have object detection that will tell you, hey, I'm 77% sure that this is Bart Simpson and he is here in the image. And the cool thing about custom vision is that it is not just an API. You can export your model to make it run locally. So you can export it to WinML. You can actually get like a Docker file where it actually runs in. You can get a TensorFlow model or an iOS CoreML model out of it. So you just export it and run it natively on your telephone. So let me show you a little bit on how this custom vision service looks like. So you go to this portal, customvision.ai, and you log in with your Microsoft account. And you don't have to have like an Azure subscription to get started, and it will cost you nothing for the first for two projects at the moment. So here we have like two projects. You can create a new project, you give it a name, and you choose the type, and you select the domain where it is from. So if you want to classify food, you just select food. And if you want to export your model, you have to choose a compact model, because only compact models can be exported at this time. So I'm not going to bore you with uploading a bunch of images, so I've already done that for you. So here we see that I've uploaded a lot of stickers. And it is very important when you upload images that only the image is on the photo. And that makes that you don't have to select all the objects. And you have to photograph it from like lots of different angles and take around 30 to 50 images to make it work really good. And use also different backgrounds, because otherwise it is going to classify your background. So you can quickly test it here by browsing. So here I have a C# sticker. It will classify it and it will tell me, hey, this is a sticker and it is about C#. So it's pretty cool by uploading just a bunch of images, and you can actually do that, export it and run on your computer, local computer. So you can export your model here. But you first have to put it on a compact model and run train. So the training takes about like 1 minute, like 2 minutes. And then you can actually run it on your local device. So I have a small app running on my mobile phone, which is actually here. It's like a custom vision demo. Well, the thing is training. So if I run it over here, it should tell me this is coding as my birthright sticker. And that has just been done by uploading a few images to there, to that website. So, and that was really cool that we could export it. So we didn't need a connection to the cloud. And that is always cool when you are in remote villages. So then the second thing we needed was that we could read the handwriting on this object. And not only my handwriting, but everyone's handwriting, because creating your own handwriting classifier is not that difficult. But reading everyone's handwriting is another story. So luckily, Microsoft also had an API for that. And they have like the Custom Vision API. And that is quite a big API. It can do a lot of things. It can, first of all, tell you what it sees on the image. So if you upload this image, it will tell you a man flying through the air while riding a skateboard. So that's pretty accurate. Not all the time. If you upload this one, it will tell you a man water skiing behind a boat. But it also gives you like a set of tags with a confidence score, which are actually almost always right. It will detect who is on the images. If they're famous enough, it will show you and it will tell you where they are. It will read just text. It will do default OCR. and it will read handwritten text in images. So that is exactly what we needed. So let me show you a quick demo of that. So all these Microsoft demos are available on the Microsoft website, where you can just play around with them and can see if they actually work and can be a benefit for you. So here you see it classified live, don't talk me about live, by just uploading my own handwriting to it. So now we can do what we wanted. We can do the object detection and we can read the handwriting. So by combining cognitive services, you get like really cool results. So what we do in the app is we scan the object, we classify every frame. If the frame rate, if the confidence score hits like 90% into seeing the object, we snap a picture, we send it to the Vision API and we read the handwriting and we look up the patient file afterwards. So if we look at how the demo, how it works in iOS, and it goes pretty fast, up you see like the confidence score it has of the object it is looking for. It's now scanning the text, sending it to the cloud, and it will give us back what is on the object. So it actually works. So that is really awesome. So in the next release, this is going to be in for the people that we don't recognize by the Face API. So another thing that I noticed when I was there and testing the app was that nurses really like to make notes. And I had like a small field where they can type. So they ended up typing 5 minutes for every patient to leave like a decent report. So I thought that could be a bit faster. And that is why I thought, let's do record the report and then later on process it back from speech to text. So do that on the background and write it in the report, because no one has to read the report instantly because the treatment is done. So I digged a little bit around on the internet to see what was there for speech. And I found this interesting video that I just had to share with you here.
Speaking. It's one of the most natural things we do. It's also the basis of a remarkable research project at IBM. This is an experimental computer system that recognizes what I say. I talk, and my words appear on the computer screen. It has a business vocabulary of thousands of words, and it even knows the difference between words that sound alike but have different meanings. Watch this. Please write to Mrs. Wright right now. This computer system is another example of innovation at IBM. In fact, it's the most advanced voice recognition system of its kind, period.
So that was 1986, and I could do already that. So when I started using the speech API from Microsoft, I really had my hopes up that the technique would have been evolved much, much further than that it was there. So the speech API can do a few things. So we have text-to-speech, speech-to-text, we have speaker recognition, and we have real-time speech translation that can translate real-time from 10 languages to 52 languages. So speech-to-text is the thing I wanted to use, so that we could record the report and then convert it to text later on. And the speech-to-text can do like either a REST API call, or it can open a WebSocket and start streaming the audio. And it can do it in 10 languages, so you have to talk English for it really to work. So the app, we wanted to record the audio file, post it to the API, put it on a blob storage, and when it is put on a blob storage, Azure can trigger like an Azure function. Azure function can open a WebSocket to the Bing Speech API, and then later on we could update the patient file with the text. And it works actually quite well at the moment. So I have like a very small demo of how this can be used. So you can upload like the file we just heard from the video. It's the IBM commercial. And it is now triggering on the background an Azure function, and that will put the results back in an Azure table here. And of course, it will take a little bit, like 30 seconds, because it is streaming the audio. So we'll come back to that a bit later, hopefully. But the thing is that it can still not really do what IBM could do in 86, but it is still working fairly. So here we have the translation. And here we see it is still doing the Mrs. Wright right now. Not correct, but who could have thought that would actually be possible? So then a little bit about security. I'm not going to dive into too deep to that. So we have actually Active Directory protecting all the children's patients file. But we wanted to add something extra to it. We didn't want to type every time the password. So we put in speaker recognition. So in the speaker recognition API, can almost do the same as the face API. It can identify and authenticate individual users by saying a sentence. So you have to create a speaker profile for that, and that has to be done by reading one of the 10 phrases Microsoft gives you. And one of them is, my voice is my passport, verify me. Like those small sentences you have to read. You have to create a verification profile and roll the phrase you have to read 3 times. And then your profile is created. It is as easy as that. And these are just 4 API calls. Then on the other side, you can verify the speaker by recording the phrase, calling the API, and handling the response. But if you try this out, be sure that you send the correct audio format to the API. Otherwise, it will give you just back a bunch of errors and exceptions, and it will not tell you what you've done wrong. So cognitive services, we have seen now a few out of 30, are for me like a really cool way and a great way to kickstart like an intelligent project. It doesn't take much time to integrate this technology because it is mostly like 4 or 5 API calls. So before you start training your own models and go and all of that, try out some of the cognitive services to see if it is actually benefiting your project, and if it is actually useful to invest your time in that. So we have some future steps for this app, and that is we want to build our own wound classifier. So this app is now collecting all photos of all wounds of all the children. We get like around 1,000 a week in, but we need like 1 million or 2 million to actually start building our own classifier. And another thing I would like to introduce to this project is Project Prague. And Project Prague is a project that lives like in the Microsoft Cognitive Services Labs. And it is a project, it is an API that runs locally on your computer to incorporate gestures in your application. So you can like swipe and do things in front of the camera, and your apps respond to that. The only downside is that you need like a very strong, not really expensive, but you need a powerful PC to run these cameras. You need a RealSense camera from Intel, or you need a Microsoft Kinect camera, at least something with a depth sensor in it, for it to work. So when you install this thing, this SDK, on your computer, and you get this client running, and you see it can really accurately track your hand movement, and it can even track 2 hands at the same time. So if you want to use this in a C# application, you just reference the SDK and you start typing it. You start this, what you see there. You start dividing by your hand poses, like a fist and peace. And then you start creating a gesture by combining these 2 hand poses. You register it at the surface, and then you can trigger an action if the gesture is triggered. So that piece of code does this. And that is all you need to incorporate these gestures. So, but out of the box, when you install it, you get like a lot of cool extra features for Windows with it. And that is, you can control PowerPoint with it just by sitting behind your computer. Type and send your email away, hang up Skype in a really cool way. Manipulate things in 3D. So if you do a lot of modeling, it can be useful. Just never leave your chair when you're doing YouTube. Maximize. Pause it. Add it to your favorites in Edge. And this is how you want to use Facebook. Swipe and like. So really cool, but you need like a powerful PC for that. So I hope they will make it a bit more accessible for also smaller devices. So a small recap of what we have discussed. We use face identification to identify our patients. If it doesn't work, we use custom and computer vision combined to recognize them. We do speech recognition for making notes and speaker recognition for an extra layer of authentication. So I want to thank you. And if you have any questions, let me know.
Hello. Cool. Thank you for your talk. I have a question. How did you handle data corruption? Like when you had invalid data going inside your system and you're supposed to learn on top of that?
Yes. So we're not the Face API. We're checking it with that check we can do. And I personally look now every time through the images to see if they're actually correct. Through my backend. And for the wound classifier, yeah, we're now just in the stage of collecting the data. And we didn't do any data science on it or reviewed it yet. Does that answer your question?
Kind of, yes. Thank you.
Hi. Hi, my name is Uwe. I was going to ask you, in this very project, what about the costs besides the lab stuff, which is free, you talked about?
Yeah, the costs.
Roundabout, just as a...
The running cost of the Azure solution is at the moment 200 euros a month.
Okay.
It runs on two web apps that are like 60 euros each. Cosmos database is like 30 euros for two regions. And the storage and the cognitive services are almost like a few euros a month.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Hi. Did you encounter any legal problems uploading medical data of individuals to your cloud?
Not yet. No, and we are operating under Ugandan law because it is a Ugandan NGO. So they're not so forward and nobody asked me any questions about that yet. But what I can say about the Face API, that is the data I've put in there is not being used for Microsoft to train their vision models. It is my data and I control it and I can remove it. And that is the promise they make in their terms and conditions.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, my name is Aman, and do you also plan to link this to somehow with treatment, or is it already in the plan, the recognition of the patient with the treatment methodology?
Yeah, so that are basically now two separate things. So we have like the identification thing connected to Cosmos. And then one part of the app is now really making photos and classify every photo of a wound. But it will take you like maybe a few weeks to add other things, as long as it is a photo you're making. So we're not planning on that because our NGO is not doing that at the moment, but technically it is very well possible to do it, or even fork the project and do your own thing.
Hi, Alan here. Probably a very common question. How well does your app work when the internet connection is not available? Do you cache the data and send it back when you get to you get a Wi-Fi or something? Or what functionalities don't work?
No, actually nothing works if there is no internet. So we need a connection to our API at the moment. But what we have now in Uganda is we have like three different phones that make a hotspot for three different telecom providers. So we will always have one that works. So that is how we solve that. But it would be good if we built in something like that. But that is like a very time-consuming thing. And we were more focusing on get the app actually collecting the data in the field than focusing on the data in the app and the async things.
Can I ask a follow-up question about the cost, maybe? That
yes.
You mentioned the cost before were 200 euros. That doesn't include the data cost for sending all this data back and forth to the cloud.
No, that actually, the data in Uganda is cheap. You get like 10 GBs for roughly 15 euros. So in every image is like half an MB we send. So there are some costs on that too.
Thank you.
Did you think of using the handwriting AI for digitizing the data that was recorded formerly in the books for the treatments?
No. I don't think I get the question. Or can you repeat it?
You showed these little books that the nurses recorded by hand.
Oh yeah.
All these treatments and for working with the children efficiently, it appears meaningful to have this data in a short time. So if it was digitized, then the search would be easier than in the books.
Yes, thank you. Now I get it. Yes, that is actually a very good idea. I didn't even think about it on doing that. So, but these APIs should be able to do that. You send up the text, you get it back and put it in the patient file. Only someone really has to start matching the names, because we just collect a face and we don't collect any other personal data from the patient than the face and the wounds.
Hello, my name is Darius. You are currently in the build-up process with getting all the images of the different wounds, and all of that data is only on external wounds and infections and all that stuff. I wanted to ask, are you expanding in that direction to other medical fields, like, I don't know, maybe something that's not only external, or is it really just with the camera and all that stuff?
Yes, for me, for this project, it is really like the wounds. Mm. But there are some really cool machine learning models already trained to do other things like brain scans and detecting cancer and tumors and those things. There are a lot of models already out there that do that, and it is also quite hard to get the data for.
Yeah, they don't share it, I can't believe.
No.
Thank you.
You're welcome. I think that is it. So thank you all and enjoy the rest of the conference.